extremely happy to be associated with this program today, where we are talking about popularizing remote sensing and geospatial databases for mapping and developmental activities. My focus of today's presentation will be on Bhuvan-based geoportal activities that has been started by ISRO some time back. I would like to give you an update of the various actions that has been taken by us, which enables the geospatial data to be used extensively in the country, both at the central as well as the state level. As we all know, Bhuvan was brought into the public domain in 2009, around August 2009, and this occasion proved to be a very interesting occasion because we did a lot of work in just about 6 to 8 months to realize Bhuvan geoportal. The advantages and significance of this Bhuvan portal was that it consisted of completely Indian images and Indian maps put out on our own geoportal that has been operationalized using the open source platform. When we realized it, it was the best resolution what we could put that time immediately for the entire country was 5.8 meter resolution. But subsequently, a lot of activities have taken place on Bhuvan platform, wherein it has enabled much higher resolution satellite data as well as large scale maps that can be used by the user community. Today we are talking about 2.5 meter resolution as well as 1 meter resolution satellite data that could be used by the user community. And we also have plans to have regular updates of both these resolutions of data so that the users both at rural and urban can utilize this data for varieties of activities. We predominantly use for the CartoSat series of satellite data for very high resolution imaging, including the ResourceSat data for multi-temporal and multi-spectral coverages, which helps images to be rendered in color at the same time, making the thematic maps easily analyzable and understandable. Bhuvan has a very interesting combination of tools and technologies, which possibly I'll be highlighting to you shortly. Bhuvan basically looks at the two-dimensional and three-dimensional images that can be rendered at high resolution. In addition to that, it has vast number of mobile applications that can be used, and it works on any type of platform. User need not be really worried about the different types of platform he has. So it could work on a Linux machine or a Mac or even on a Windows machine. Basically, the Windows-based platform was the initial release, and subsequently we released it out on to the various other platforms also. If you see the journey of Bhuvan has basically got released in 2009 as a simple infrastructure. We just started off with 8 to 10 servers. Then slowly we improved upon the infrastructure because we started realizing the requirements of the user community and how we can leverage the infrastructure as well as the networks so that we can reach out to a large number of people. Of course, initially the first day of release we had more than 5 crore people trying to log into Bhuvan, and we did have trouble in meeting the responsibilities or requirements of all the people. But we could realize quickly, and then we made a lot of tweaking on the software so that it could be reached out to a large number of people. So the phase 1 and phase 2 from 2009 down to 2013-14 saw a lot of changes taking place with respect to the server farm build-up, the infrastructure build-up, the huge amount of hard disk space build up. In addition to that, varieties of other tools and technologies that we could make available so that quickly we were able to meet large number of users, at the same time see the requirements in the future and look at the visioning of Bhuvan so that we could meet more challenges in the future. But the most interesting thing that happened was subsequently, that was in 2014-15 onwards, wherein we were able to bring in large number of servers. We added about 34 servers into the system, and that was able to give a lot of information for people at a faster rate. And we slowly started building the systems in a distributed platform so that we can reach out to the people through the regional servers. So we tried to build some regional services through the regional remote sensing service centers of NRSC, wherein we were able to add additional servers in that. At the same time, during this particular time frame in 2013 and 14, we had large number of software releases including APIs. We had 31 releases in 2013 and about 26 plus releases in 2014. Basically, these are special services for the user community so that the users can utilize various technologies. So slowly the platform turned into a national geospatial governance platform, in addition to the developmental aspects, and also major flagship programs of the Government of India started trickling into this particular system, in addition to enthusing the state governments also to start looking at Bhuvan as a one-stop shop solution for varieties of their requirements in the states. So if you look at the journey, we started with a small number of servers. Today we are talking about 70 plus servers. It's a bigger server platform. It has distributed computing environment. That means a central server platform is there at NRSC. At the same time, you have regional platforms, you have state level platforms, and also a few central government platforms are also hosting Bhuvan at their respective installations. And we are around the corner ready for releasing another 100 servers as part of a major update of the hardware. That means we are going to be reaching out to larger number of people, larger number of users in a very short time. So this particular build-up has helped us to leverage both the computational platform as well as the network-based platform to see that this particular engine can reach out to large number of people. Of course, there are large number of challenges when you go on adding the hardware and the networks. We also need to have large number of applications developed and reach out to the user platforms. So if you look at the Bhuvan geospatial platform, it has different types of facilities. In fact, the entire facility that is available on Bhuvan is showcased in the very first mashup itself when one enters the Bhuvan. It is particularly started off as a visualization platform, but down the line we have moved into the mobile platform. We have more than 60 to 70 mobile applications that are operational on Bhuvan. In addition to that, large number of maps and map analytics are possible, and there are state-based platforms wherein respective state governments will be able to use this particular data for state-specific purposes. And of course, the state governments can build over it by putting their own data and inserting onto the system. The very interesting thing about Bhuvan, in addition to all these, is that it has got a one-stop shop for all the kind of disasters that the country faces. So it's a very good platform for disaster management support. If you look at the technicalities of Bhuvan, Bhuvan services particularly, not only that, it can be used as a non-plugin service, you can use as a plugin service also. In the sense, we have the web map services, we call it as WMS services, which is quite popular in the world, everybody uses it. But we have used it very significantly both in terms of the images rendering as well as the map rendering. And both these services from the map and the images goes through the WMS to large number of people. In addition to that, we have terrain services also put out. So all types of services that ISRO can give it to the people through the applications are made available from the WMS services, and it is particularly user centric. When we really look at the application development, there are varieties of scenarios by which the users can utilize this particular data. We have the map server, that's the basic engine which actually serves the maps and the images to the people. We have tile caches, that is, all these images and maps are actually put out, processed rather, not put out, in terms of tile caches, and these are positioned as part of geo servers and geo web cache. Once you have this particular data available, it is possible for us to have a pyramidal structure of this particular data stored in the database. And once this particular data is available in the pyramidal structure through the network, it is possible for us to meet out large number of user requirements simultaneously. That means this particular cache which is available will be able to serve large number of users simultaneously over the network so that user gets the rendering as though the whole thing is happening on his own system. In addition to these maps and images, we have also added city survey maps, the cadastral databases, and even the ward boundaries and things like that, so that locale-specific services can be utilized by the user. We also are looking towards the development of user-centric applications. User-centric applications looks very specifically with respect to the user, the way he would like to develop his own applications on a server given to him. For example, I mentioned about the regional services, the state-based services. State-specific services have the servers located in the respective states. They can have their own user services positioned by developing their own apps. They can also position their data and start pushing their data through the same service platform for the user community. So we have central services coming out from the WMS and WTM and WMTS. At the same time, the data-centric services coming out from the user who host these kind of services from the respective areas. I was talking about the mashup which has been created, which basically serves as a versatile geospatial dashboard. If you look at this dashboard, broadly it gives you the visualization services, which is on the top. We have G-governance services, which are in the middle, which is basically when you go into the system, it will be scanning through. You can choose any one of these services. We have specific application sectors where people will be interested in. They can enter into any one of these application sector and then look at what one can do with that. At the same time, you have the special applications that are built, which could be used by the user community in different ways. In addition to these mashup, on the right-hand side of the portal, you will also see the state portals where any particular state can be picked up and get into the details of the various states. Some examples of how the rendering of this particular data can be shown to you. We have very high resolution data, which is possible today because of the availability of CARTOSAT 2 series of satellites, which enables us to put one meter resolution of data very easily for large number of areas, which can be used very smoothly and very effectively for various user community based requirements. In addition to that, large scale mapping possibilities are also there, wherein it allows programs like Amrit and Smart Cities could use this particular data. The example which I am showing here is a very high resolution map of thick urban population, which can be very nicely mapped, and you can bring out these kind of maps which could be usable by the user community for specific activities of urban development, urban planning, and even coming out with the master plans. Not only this, the Bhuvan also allows you to bring in the real life image textures on the footprint of the satellite data. That means you have the high resolution footprint and you can make image textures by taking the photographs on the ground. Especially it will enthuse the younger generation when they would like to take ground pictures of some typical monuments, for example, and they would like to position that on the top of the footprint of the image, so that it gives you a real-time rendering, a real-life image rendering on the top of a geospatial platform. So Bhuvan supports these kind of things in the 3D platform. What I am showing you here in this particular slide is the Mount Everest. I don't know how many of you have really gone to Mount Everest, but you can do a virtual reality of Mount Everest online when you look at the imaging capability of Bhuvan. What I am right now showing is the peak of the Mount Everest, slightly improved part of the image, but one can go to the three-dimensional platform where you can start looking at the visualization of the Himalayas itself. This is a typical example of rendering how you can do. You can see the top of the Everest very clearly shown to you, and the various snow and glacier exercises that can be done by a user who would like to understand the three-dimensional possibilities of this particular terrain. We are trying to move into more amount of analytics today on the Bhuvan. Technically speaking, we have been working on the parametric classifiers earlier days. We are trying to build newer techniques and newer mechanisms by which younger community can participate with us in developing tools for machine learning and deep learning techniques. We are all aware of the artificial neural networks that has been used pretty extensively for mapping. Particularly the self-learning and backpropagation techniques have been extensively used, but I would like to encourage the younger generation to work with us on newer techniques, particularly with respect to the deep learning techniques, which is becoming quite popular for varieties of classification of images and even intelligent image classification and things like that. In addition to that, ISRO also looks at evolutionary algorithms to be used, like genetic algorithms for classifiers, and also the nature-inspired optimization algorithms, which are very, very important for rendering and even classifying or even processing some of the large amount of data that we are getting into the system. Today, Bhuvan handles terabytes of data on a daily basis. We need to have innovative methods by which we can handle large amount of data. Some of the typical examples of large-scale maps are shown here, wherein one can use it for tourism purposes, or it is possible for you to use it for municipal GIS and things like that, and including positioning the Bhuvan for even school. NCERT syllabus is put onto this particular system. Entire schooling community in the country can use school Bhuvan techniques very clearly. ISRO is moving into a newer area for location-based services today. We have the constellation of NAVIC available with us, and we also have the GPS aided geo-augmented navigation system. We call it as Gagan, which allows you to go down to something like less than 2 meter resolution on the ground when you are using this particular tool. These two technologies are allowing India to use indigenous techniques for location-based services. There are many examples which are coming forward. For example, we have many applications which are available on mobile, which talk to the NAVIC through a simple first-generation device, which talks to the mobile device through the Bluetooth. It is possible for you to use the indigenous GPS system, and a large number of applications are already built on this. I thought I'll specifically highlight some of the applications on disaster management, particularly on the flood, forest fire, cyclone, landslides and earthquake, because these are the applications which are important to be highlighted. The other applications are already highlighted by some of my colleagues who have talked about Bhuvan and also demonstrated Bhuvan. If you look at the kind of disasters the country faced in 2013 and 14, I think some of the rare events happened in the country which created a lot of problems for us to have better preparedness. That is the time onwards ISRO started moving into near real-time imaging, near real-time positioning of our Bhuvan-based disaster management support system. If you look at the example of Uttarakhand, we had a major problem in Kedarnath, which made us learn a lot of new methods by which we can try to give near real-time pictures of the kind of things happening on the ground. This particular image highlights to you the actual Chorabari Tal disaster, wherein the entire water due to very heavy incessant rain that created problem on Kedarnath. This is a three-dimensional output which has been generated from the Cartosat stereo data, which allows you to visualize and understand the complications involved in this particular area, when we witnessed more than 5,000 landslides in a very short time, and we were able to quickly analyze the data with multi-time data, and also we were able to position a GIS data on the amount of impact that created on the dwellers of this area. In addition to that, we have quickly brought in various software tools for looking at such kind of problems through geotagging on the ground. That can be used for field data collection. A lot of users have started using it as part of the crowdsourcing, where mobile apps are being used on the ground for giving wide varieties of data. Uttarakhand disaster itself was very closely seen by about 100 students in the field, where they were able to use our mobile tools and provide large amount of data in a short time that could be positioned on the portal, which were of great use for the local authorities. Manu was the program, basically mapping the neighborhood in Uttarakhand. In addition to that, we have an active system which gives SMS alerts on near real-time mode for locating the forest fires that could be countered on the ground. Here is a mechanism by which the daily active fire alerts in the fire season is activated using this particular system. This is an example of how we did it for Uttarakhand, which was one of the recent forest fires which we faced. And during this entire season, all the forest department get direct information from our SMSs, which are linked to 4-time alerts that we get from the space-based systems. On the flood front and cyclone, this is an example of Filin, wherein we are able to exactly track the path of the cyclone right from the prediction, early prediction onwards. You will be able to exactly get the details of when it is going to strike and where is the going to be the landfall, so that the ground system, particularly the collectors and the authorities at the local level, will be able to plan well in advance. Both the Hudud and Filin were very actively, ISRO actively participated in these things and provided excellent pictures on a regular basis. And today, in fact, India is in a very good position where INSAT 3D and 3DR gives you every 15-minute location information, particularly on these conditions. In addition to that, the regular weather monitoring can be done using our systems. You can see the example here wherein post-disaster also, we continue to provide the pictures where it gives you the exact inundation where it has happened, and you can zoom into the area where even up to the village level you can get the information, which is highly useful for the local authorities. This is another example where again the geotagging techniques have been used under the disaster conditions to see where exactly the trouble has been placed on the ground, and this kind of real-time pictures from the field also helps the ground authorities in understanding where exactly what has happened. This is an example of Hudud, where it gives you information about the kind of disaster that has struck on the ground. At the same time, the classification of information with respect to the mobile data that provides us exact information about the kind of problems that has been faced. Moving to the other areas where we saw major disasters, particularly in the case of Srinagar, the Jammu Kashmir in 2014 experienced massive floods in this area, which again enabled us to quickly position our systems, and we were able to move in a lot of data for the local authorities to use this particular data. At another new area in the higher reaches of Himalayas, which we are using quite consistently, is on the landslides. The Puktal landslide was very accurately analyzed by us, and quantitative information was provided not only with respect to the debris that was formed, also with respect to the exact calculations of the amount of debris which is there and the mechanism by which one can clear it so that you can release the water systematically. An artificial lake kind of a situation was formed as part of the transboundary landslide impact also, wherein Nepal had this problem of landslide which created problem, and we could work with Nepal very closely to see that we could avert a major disaster that could have caused, just like the Kosi River disaster which had been caused earlier. This was again on Sun Kosi, we were able to solve it. So space is helping in a big way through the Bhuvan geoportal, so that we are able to avert many different types of disasters which occurs anytime in the entire season. Particularly the rainy season causes more problems as compared to the others, especially in the cyclone. Cyclone conditions, the conditions are much more severe, but nevertheless, the disaster management support system of ISRO through the Bhuvan is already always available for the entire country to utilize it in a meaningful way. Before I close, I would like to say a few things wherein we would like to also talk about what we would like to do for Bhuvan in the future. Bhuvan is moving into the big data analytics, because Bhuvan gets diversified data. It's not just the image data. We get the map data, we get the field data, we get the data from mobile platforms, we get the data from even UAVs. So when you have versatile platforms by which you are able to assimilate this kind of data and use it for various analytical solution, so that the users can quickly get the results out of the multiple data sets what comes in. So Bhuvan looks at the big data analytics in the future. Yet another important area Bhuvan obviously would like to look at is the intelligent data processing. And we would like to have a large number of younger generation working with us to see that they become shoulder to shoulder with us and solve some of these intelligent data processing problem. As I mentioned already, we are into the machine learning and deep learning techniques, and we would like to make them online available, particularly which we don't have today. We would like to process such kind of data online so that large number of users in the country get the advantage of this kind of data availability. The universe is going towards 40 plus zettabytes of global data out of which 2.5 zeta plus zettabytes of data will be poured in by India itself by 2020. If you look at the Facebook today, we talk about more than 700,000 updates per minute. And if you talk about the Twitter, which generates more than 12 terabytes of data per day, when we are looking at such kind of data, Bhuvan, when we are talking about terabytes of data being handled on a daily basis, is not a small thing. It is going to be a big thing. So we need to look at a bigger solution provision possibility from the user community. We move towards that, and we certainly look forward to a large number of users participating in making Bhuvan much more versatile, more user-friendly, and at the same time, reaching out to all the people in the country and meeting the requirements of the country through the governments, both at the central and at the state. Thank you very much.